May I now ask Mr. Rajeev Bhattacharya from Guwahati to kindly make his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I feel honored to be speaking on this occasion, and I thank NIAS for giving me this beautiful opportunity, and especially Dr. Mail, Ramya, Suparna, we have been in touch for quite a long time, and I hope Dr. Mail gets well soon. Well, this is quite a vast topic, and summing it up in 20 minutes is really a tough challenge, so I'll go really very fast. Well, if we talk about the challenges on the Indo-Myanmar border, I would like to categorize them into, there are five issues, I believe. These are the major challenges on the Indo-Myanmar border. Now, among these five issues, my perception is that the biggest challenge for the Indian government is in the integration of the border areas, not insurgency. Insurgency is going to fizzle out from the northeast. If you have a look at the statistics of insurgency-related incidents for the last 15 years, you'll find it's going down. Insurgency is a response, is a violent response to some anomaly in the region. So insurgency, in my perception, is fizzling out. Even the rebel bases in Myanmar, which I'll come to that later on, I don't see the possibility of rebel bases in Myanmar, rebels operating out of the bases in Myanmar for a very long time. So the biggest challenge for the Indian government is the integration of the border areas with the mainstream. Unfortunately, I don't see any policy, very concrete and long-term policy of the Indian government. For the last 70 years, we are almost, after 2 years, we will be 70 years of independence, but I don't really see any long-term perspective. It's really very unfortunate. You go to the border areas, you'll know what I'm talking about. So let's now very briefly come one by one to all these issues. This is the map of the Indo-Myanmar border. It starts right from Arunachal, ends at Mizoram, 1643 kilometers. So these are the main issues in the integration of the border areas. As rightly pointed out by Mr. Kinmong, the two areas on the Indian side and also on the Myanmari side, they are one of their most underdeveloped regions in both the countries. Perhaps the situation in Myanmar, as he rightly said, it's beyond the reach of the Myanmarese government. They're trying. Maybe after 10 years, the situation is going to change. It's very necessary to understand that. Myanmar is not a very rich country. It has opened up now. Maybe after 10, 20 years, it's going to be a rich country. It doesn't have the resources, to my understanding. So there is a big gap between the goals formed up by the Indian government and the ground reality. If you go to the border areas, you'll yourself see what I'm talking about. So my contention is, it is high time the Indian government should reconceptualize the Northeast. It's high time. There are 8 states in the region. No 2 states are similar. And I don't really know if the Indian government understands this. You take up any 2 states, Manipur, Nagaland, Arunachal, Assam, Arunachal, Nagaland, Tripura, Mizoram, no 2 states are similar. So one policy cannot be applicable in all the states. This is very vital. Now, this border region of 1643 kilometers, I would divide this into divide that into 5 sectors. Now, starting from this area, you see this area, this is in Arunachal Pradesh. This is an inaccessible area. Now, about 5 years back, I thought that I would go to this area. I had to come back. The locals told me you will have to be a mountaineer to go to this region. So I came back. I have now decided to enroll myself in a mountaineering course as soon as possible so that I can go there again. The Assam Rifles, of course, Assam Rifles can go there, but not a layman like us. Even if I have to go there, I have to start practicing walking, climbing hills for 6 months. This region, this is Vijayanagar. This is the area where the 3 countries met. And this entire stretch, this is an inaccessible area. From the Myanmari side also, no government presence. On the Indian side, you have the Assam Rifles here, but very thin presence. Now, this is the hotspot. This borders Nagaland. This is the area that is under absolute, I won't say absolute control, it's being influenced by the Kaplang group and a CNK. This is the area I have traveled very extensively. Now, so far as the border development of border areas is concerned, this region is slightly better than this region. You have a human population here. You have some villages here. You have some schools on the Indian side. You have health centers also, but without any doctors. You have some roads. You have some amount of economic development. But on the Myanmar side, which I have gone, on the Myanmar side, frankly speaking, I haven't seen any symbols of government, any government symbol. All I have seen are a few Myanmarese teachers teaching Myanmarese language to Naga's children. This is very important. Now, why this has happened, I'll not go into all these details. Number one, Myanmarese teachers. Number two, some army barracks far on top of the mountain. One or two barracks. Number three, I have seen a Myanmarese flag in a Naga village. This is very important. These are the three government symbols I have seen. No Myanmarese army, nothing. Which is why he has rightly pointed out that villages are far apart. You can't really think of having border trade, or you can't really think of really ushering in a lot of development in a very short span of time. So this is the area, mainly, this is the area, I'm coming to that later on, where all the militant camps are located. Now this is the Manipur sector. But Manipur sector is better developed than this area or this area. This is the least developed area, slightly better than this is this area. Now when you come to the Manipur area, you have schools, you have the villages, I'm talking about the Indian side, the villages are slightly better off than the Naga villages or in Arunachal. On the Myanmar side also, you have some big towns like Homalin. Homalin is a tourist center. Now, a tourist is not allowed to go to these areas or to the Kachin areas, border areas, but tourists are allowed to go to Homalin, which is slightly located here. It's an Air Force base also, if I'm not mistaken. Homalin is there. Tamu is here. Tamu is now probably will develop into hub border trade. So these areas on both sides of the border are relatively better compared to these areas. This is Manipur sector. Then this is the Mizoram sector. This is the socio-economic development of these areas would be somewhat akin, similar to the Manipur area. This is Champai. I have marked this area. Last month I had visited this area. Now this is the latest hotspot of arms and drugs trafficking. There are two hotspots. I'll show the areas. One is the Moretamo sector, but it's going down. It's mainly the arms and drugs are flowing through this area. Because the army's presence on the Myanmar side is very less. Come down, you have this Saiha. This is the Saiha district. This is the most thickly forested area along the entire stretch of the border. It's monsoon forest, thick forest, and I would pray that your government should at least try and maintain, conserve these forests. These are lovely forests, in fact. You won't find them really. I really felt very nice when I saw this forest. In this area also you have forests. But here it's difficult to reach. Almost for 8 months of the year, you find snow. It's very difficult to reach this area. So this is the stretch, roughly the Myanmar's border. Socio-economic development is by and large very poor. Infrastructure, okay, you have good roads in Mizoram, narrow roads, you have roads in Manipur, but Nagaland, okay, in some areas it's true, but in this area it's horrible. Now, we can't always keep on blaming the government, that government hasn't done anything. Now this area above Vijayanagar, this is inhabited by the Lizu people, Lizu tribe. The Lizus are found in Kachin also, in Yunnan province also. Now, just for 10 villages or 20 villages, the government can't really be expected to spend 500 crores to build a road. This would be very foolish. And above all, we should not see development from our perspective. I believe they should be asked what development means to them. That is very important. Now, just for a few villages, you just can't really, since Myanmar is not a threat to India, Myanmar doesn't have any territorial ambitions. So just for a few villages, a government cannot be expected to build. Moreover, there is the Namdafa forest. If development, building roads and all could be a threat to the forest also. So this is the overall border area. So now, so far as border trade is concerned, these are the spots. Either the central government or the state governments have been found to be talking about these points where border trade would be developed. Right from Arunachal Pradesh to Jokathar. Now, among all these points, I find only the government paying attention to Moray. Now, 70% of all the border trade comes to Moray. ICP, integrated checkpost, is being installed here. Now, last month, I was part of a delegation. We visited Jokhathar and we crossed over to Re also. You are allowed to go to up to 10 kilometers. I also visited the Re Lake, in fact. It's a beautiful place. But 95% is smuggled, it's informal trade. So I was really surprised. I mean, how can you expect border trade to pick up so fast when nothing is there? You go to Panchao Pass, it's a very thinly populated area. I mean, you go up across the place, your lake of no return. Then Longwa. I have got photographs of Longwa. I'll show you Longwa. Now, how can you, I wonder, I mean, if you really expect border trade to really, really pick up, I think it has to be a very slow process. First, the informal trade has to be accepted and legitimized. I believe that is my perception. I mean, I don't see any kind of infrastructure, barring Moray, all these Avanku, Mimi, Pangsha, I mean, there's nothing almost. On the Myanmar side also, on the Indian side also. So maybe we are cut off from the reality. There's something, this is what I've been telling. I mean, one cannot be sitting in New Delhi and framing policies for the Northeast. Frankly speaking, it has gone for a long time. One bureaucrat comes, he comes to Home Ministry or Ministry of Finance or Trade and Commerce. He's maybe from Bihar Kader. He said he'd like to satisfy his boss. He's on deputation for 3 years. How the hell will he know all of everything about the Northeast? This is what I don't ask. These are hard realities. Let us face it. He'll simply go back to his parent Kader. He wouldn't like to dissatisfy his political bosses or his seniors. How can you sit down in Delhi and frame policies for all the 8 states? I have been reporting on the Northeast for close to 2 decades. I myself have not understood the region. This is something, these are the issues to be tackled head on. We have been avoiding these issues for a long time. This is Longwa village on the Myanmar side. You can see the condition of the village. This is the cleanest Naga village I have come across and the biggest Naga village in Upper Sagaing Division. Beyond this is a village called Loji. That's also a big village. I have gone through all these areas. Now, this is just across the Indian border. This is Longwa. Just 40 meters from this place is an Assam Rifles establishment. Now, how can you develop? Do you see those mountains? There are no roads. Road is being planned, but how can you have trade? I mean, the population is very thin. I don't know. I'm at a loss to understand. I'll show you some photographs. This is also Longwa. I showed you the mountain. This is the mountain. So no roads, nothing, we track through all these mountains. So this is the condition. Population is extremely thin. Where is the demand? I don't really know. This is the ground reality. This is Re Jokhathar, sir. So that side is Re, Myanmar. This is Jokhathar. We were allowed to go to 10 kilometers. The Re Lake is just right inside, right place. So this is a small township. So this is the ground reality again, but this is better than the Naga areas. The population is more, the socio-economic conditions are better. Then I realize what is the reason for the better, the relative, why is the socio-economic conditions better? Then again, the smuggling. Gas cylinders, such in great demand, medicines. Now I'll not be surprised, Indian government might take another 100 years to realize this. Please, don't mind. I mean, this is the fact. But the Indian government might take 100 years to realize this. People are in need of medicines. People are in need of gas cylinders. So what the hell are you doing? But let's come to insurgency. As I have said, insurgency is on its way out. Another 15 years, nature of insurgency has changed in the Northeast. I'll not go into this. This is a huge topic. If you go look at the profiles of each insurgent group, you'll know the profile. Now, along the Indo-Myanmar border, I find around 13 insurgent groups active along the border. Both Myanmarese groups and Indian Northeast groups that have camps in the region. I'll show some photographs how these camps look like. The Northeast outfits are from Assam, Manipur and Nagaland. We know what happened last May and June, 2 strikes in Mon district of Nagaland and in Manipur that killed 26 soldiers from the Indian Army and paramilitary, Assam Rifles and the Territorial Army. Now, this is how I would categorize the insurgent prone areas on the Myanmar side. Now, very interestingly, This is Vijayanagar, which I showed in the previous slide. Below Vijayanagar is an unofficial camp of the Kachin Independence Army. This is a fact. Sir, you will be knowing, I think, better than me. This is very close to an Assam Rifles camp. Let us accept it. Assam Rifles camp is somewhere very near. Kachin Independence Army cadres keep on coming regularly to Changlang town for treatment, buying medicines, food, everything. And sometimes, if they have more money, they also come to Delhi. In Delhi, there is a place called Vikashpuri. You have a huge number of Kachin refugees out there. So it's a good time for them. But this, if you ask the Kachin Independence Army people, they say, no, we don't have any camp there. This is an unofficial camp. But they don't create any problems, in fact. Come down. This is the Naga area where Kaplang rules. This is some kind of an area where Kaplang's reed runs large. He's the king. This is the area where all the other insurgent outfits, six from Manipur, two from Assam, and one from North Bengal, KLO, which is almost defunct. KLO doesn't have any camps. All these people have their concentration of camps here at four places. I'll not go into all the details. One place is Taka. Taka is west of Chinwin River, Hukong Valley. This is another area where camps are located. Now, this area, you have the Manipuri militant outfits having camps here, but this is not under the control of Kaplang. This area is purely Naga area, but when you come down to lower Sagaing division, the population pattern is it's a mixture of Shans also, you find Chins, you have Myanmaris also, you have Nagas also. So here, don't mind my words, sir, we are given to understand that these camps exist in understanding with the Myanmaris army. Or maybe should I say, I use the word a section of the Myanmaris army. Kaplang doesn't control these camps. Now, here also, some camps have surfaced in the Chin state, according to my sources of information. This is also Manipuri militant office, mainly PLA and UNLF. As you come down towards this point where the tri-junction, where Myanmar, Bangladesh and Mizoram, they meet together at this point. Now, there are reports suggesting that the Arakan army is very active here, which could be, I don't know, the Kaladan project. I've been asking some people, will that be a threat to the Kaladan project? They said no. Because of the recent disturbances in Rakhine state, this Arakan army has been severely weakened. But there are reports that the Arakan army is active in this region. So this is the overall situation on the Indo-Myanmar border, number of groups active. So most dangerous part is this part, where the recent massacres have been carried out, where the Indian army had also carried out two cross-border strikes. This is certain. Two cross-border strikes were carried out, one across Tuen Sang, one across Ukhrul, but just about 2 to 3 kilometers from the border, it's confirmed. But 83 militants, 100 militants have not been killed. My information suggests only 3 militants killed. Official sources suggest 6 militants killed. This is the estimate. So this is the grand old man, SS Kaplang. This is from Taka. The place from where he has his headquarters, the place where all the rebel groups have the headquarters. This is in Hukong Valley. I had gone there in 2011-12. So this is Kaplang, SS Kaplang. This is Paresh Borua. This is the Alpha Camp in Taka again. This is the PLA camp. Not in Northern Sagaing Division, below, which is not under the control of Kaplang. This is one of the second largest underground outfit in the Northeast. The biggest is the next photograph, UNLF. This is the biggest, currently the biggest underground outfit, United National Liberation Front. This camp is also not in Northern Sagaing Division. This is again below, across Chandel district. There's a place called Old Sumdal. Now you have to walk, I haven't gone to this camp. So you have to walk for around 2 days through Old Sumdal. That is all over. Insert now, let's come to small arms proliferation. Small arms
are available, at least in two places in the northeast. One is Moray, the other is Dimapur. If you have very good contacts, you'll be able to purchase all these kinds of small arms. Also now I have been hearing that if you have contacts in Champai, Mizoram area also, because the routes are changing now. These are, the sources are, one is Yunnan, the other is some arms factories have come up in Kachin at a place called Pangwa. I don't know if I've written that name, Pangwa, P-A-N-G-W-A. This has been set up by the Kachin Independence Army. Another factory has come up in the Wa region. That has been, according to our sources of information, some Chinese engineers who were earlier working with the ordnance factory Norinco. They have come and helped set up some arms factories in the Wa region. Now these Northeast rebels have received some consignments from these factories also. But the major source is Yunnan province. So Moray and Dimapur are the major hotspots. Even the Dimapur, it's heard that some militant outfits control the illicit trade. The small arms, suppose an AK-81 rifle, now it's available at 4.5 lakhs in Moray, or maybe 4.2 lakhs. By the time it comes to Dimapur, it shoots up by another 30,000-40,000 rupees. So these are the places through which arms pass through basically. One is Champai. The other two routes are, small arms come through all these routes, but this is the most active route now, through Champai, through Mizoram. This route is also very, 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 is quite active now. And I don't understand what was the logic behind fencing 10 kilometers at Moray. I fail to understand, in fact, why was the 10 kilometers, Indian government has fenced 10 kilometers here. I really don't understand what was the logic behind fencing that this sector. It's completely, I mean, this entire stretch. Again, in FAK also, there have been occasions when arms have passed through the FAK district. But this route has now, it's not very active, but still there are possibilities. These are the three places. But these are Chinese weapons, basically. This was Borderland Libers and Tigers when they laid down weapons in 2003. These are all Chinese weapons. Now, rightly as official sources have told me that Indian government has taken up the issue with China. Okay, weapons are coming from your place. They are landing up in the hands of militants. But China says, where is the evidence? This is all nonsense. Now, I'll show you a very interesting piece of evidence. Sorry. Do you see these two Chinese alphabets? This is very rare. In the mid-90s, when consigned, around 2001, 2003, two, three consignments had come to the Northeast. In that consignment, there were some weapons like this AK-47, where two Chinese new alphabets were inscribed. I found this in Karbi Anglo. But nowadays, you don't find any Chinese, they care to eliminate all traces, in fact. But this weapon I had found in Karbi Anglo with UPDS. I immediately took the photograph. There are two Chinese letters, which means that it has been coming from China. Otherwise, it's very difficult to pin down China. It's difficult to confirm them with evidence that, okay, arms have been coming, weapons have been coming from your place. And let me also tell you, lest I be misunderstood, this is an official policy of China as it seems. It's not that China is selling weapons only to Northeast rebels. They sell it to anybody and everybody. Okay, just finish. Drug trafficking, quickly. There are three trends in drug trafficking. One is consumption of raw opium. One is YABA or synthetic drugs, ATS, which we call. Another is injectable form of heroin, number four. Among all these items, it is heroin number four that has been causing maximum addiction in cities of the Northeast. It has been coming to Kolkata also. This is YABA. This is heroin number four. This is an opium field I found in Northern Sarang Division. Especially opium is sown around October, November. The bulb is cut around February, March. When you walk through that area, in remote areas you find all these opium, beautiful opium plants in fact. This is how opium is smoked, raw opium. This was a Naga chief in a Myanmarese village. So this is all. So any questions I'd like to answer?
Thank you.
Thank you. I would just like to add one thing. You know, one of the major arms market in the whole of Southeast Asia happened to be Bangkok. The resolution of few of the lingering conflicts, be it the case of Moro Islamic Liberation Front, which was in Philippines, or for that matter, the Gerakan Aceh Merdeka, which was in Aceh, the 3 decades long conflict have ended, and the major supply of arms to these two basic regions have come down. So probably this is the reason that most of the arms find their way to Northeast. Thank you.